in, everybody, to Untold Sports Stories with Gerardo Byrne. I got a very special guest with me, Coach Nick Johnson. Coach, I'm always going to call you Coach. That's just it's a habit of mine. Coach Nick Johnson on the show. We are going to be discussing the whole football program and what we can discuss of the football program when he was told he was no longer going to be employed by the school to coach football. And we're going to talk a lot about his family situation. His family situation is very public. It's gone to national news, ESPN, all other sorts of news media. So we'll get into that in a little bit. Coach Johnson, how you doing?
I'm doing great. Really glad to be here. Always a pleasure to see you. You're really a joy to be around.
I appreciate you coming on the show. Now, before we get into all that, we'll take it back from the beginning. Where did you grow up around the Midwest area?
I did. I'm from Fort Wayne, which is 2 hours north of here. Town of about 250,000 people. Really nice place, God City. So I've been an Indiana guy my whole life. So
you got a twin brother?
I have a twin brother.
You both growing up playing football?
Both. We didn't necessarily grow up playing football. It's something we got into in junior high. So my parents were looking for something for us to do to get us out of the house. Mm-hmm. I was looking for a way to make connections socially. And in sixth grade, I went to a football game and had a bunch of friends that were on the football team. And I went with two young ladies that had already tackled me in the friend zone for a safety. So I was trying to figure out, how can I get more women to pay attention to me? And they just stood by the rail and commented on how much they liked the football guys and how cute they were in their uniforms. And I was sold at that point. I was like, if I'm going to get a girlfriend, I got to play football. And so on a side note, I tried out for football. My brother and I, we both made the team in seventh grade. And I didn't have a girlfriend from seventh grade until I finished football my senior year in high school. So I had an original mission that didn't get accomplished, but the mission that was supposed to be accomplished did. I think playing football obviously did a lot for me.
You might not have got a girlfriend straight out of high school or playing football till high school, but one thing that did come out of it was getting able to have an opportunity to play college football.
Yeah, absolutely. And all the other things that come with being in sports, discipline, character, learning how to work on teams, learning how to deal with adversity to a greater degree, and time management. Just a lot of wonderful aspects that you get from being a student athlete.
Did you know about Earlham before you came here?
I did not. I had not known about Earlham. In fact, I had a family friend attend Earlham College, and I didn't even know about Earlham until I got to Earlham, and another friend said, "Oh, you're from Fort Wayne. Do you know Cecily?" I was like, I recognize that name. Yeah, her family's the base. That's where Lily. Yeah, she graduated a couple years ago. I was like, this is where she went to school? I thought she went to Indiana Tech across the street, but no, she came down here.
So what got you to come? How did you end up at Earlham playing football?
Well, it's really a neat story, I guess. Neat to me, probably not to anybody else. A guy named Stan Hill, who works in our department now, I'm in institutional advancement here at Earlham. He's also in institutional advancement, a longtime Earlham guy. Was an assistant coach, an alumnus of the college, All-American for them, and the Hall of Famer for Earlham football. Was recruiting and came to our school. I have a twin brother, although we don't look like twins. In high school, he was about 6'3", 260, was an all-city offensive lineman. And in high school, I was about 6'3", 205, like with all the gear on, drenched in water, heavy curl activator. So I was kind of like a side piece, but a lot of places were very interested in my brother as an offensive lineman. Mm-hmm. He played center guard and tackle. And so he had been talking to Anderson, he had been talking to Trine, he had been talking to a couple of other places, Manchester, I believe, at the time, and nobody had come to see me. Nobody was really interested in for whatever reason, probably the film. My film was really bad. Although I did lead our team in touchdowns that year. I fell on a block punt in the end zone.
Hey.
It counts, right?
It counts, though.
So, but nobody had expressed interest. Well, Earlham was interested in my brother and the other outside linebacker on our team who ended up going to St. Joseph's. And my brother's whole thing was, I want to go where both of us can attend. He was like, that's my twin. We've been roommates for, 18 years and 9 months. We just gonna keep the trend going for another four. And so they called me down to meet with Stan Hill. So it was me, my brother, and the other gentleman. And we met with Stan, and he just kind of sold us on Earlham to take a look at it and did a fantastic job, and Coach Hill did. And what really was remarkable to me, as opposed to some of the other college visits we did, we had visited Mount Union before Irwin College. And when we went to Mount Union, I mean, they really didn't even care that we were there. And, I mean, I think a 250-pound high school offensive lineman in the late 90s is pretty good size. And they thought he was small. And they were multiple-time national champions.
Yeah, Mount Union is known nationally. Yeah, Division 250-pound players are probably their linebackers or running backs.
Well, they thought I was a receiver at 205 pounds, and they found out I couldn't catch. They didn't want anything to do with me. And so we met an intern assistant coach and an intern from admissions, and they walked us around campus, and we stayed the night with a guy on their JV team and all that. Just didn't really feel I felt the celebration of the victory and how good they were, but didn't feel like it was the right place for me.
Gotcha.
And when I visited Earlham, the head coach, Frank Carr, and another assistant coach, Jason Reedy, they got in vans and they drove up to Fort Wayne to get my brother and I and a few other kids. And they took like 7 to 14 of us back down themselves and talked to us the whole time themselves. And we met everybody on the team. There's about 50 guys on the team. We met everybody on the team, met a bunch of people on campus. Some of those people became good friends of mine just from that visit that night. I met two guys that were from my high school that were a year older than my brother and I that were on the basketball team. I had no idea they were going to school here and playing. Like, I had never heard of Irwin College. So Stan said, "Oh, we're in Richmond." I was like, "Oh, Virginia, that's cool. My mom's from Virginia." He was like, "Richmond, Indiana." And then we were like, "Tom Raper's RVs," because everybody knew where that was at the time. And I think it's Camping World now. But anyway, the visit was just so good. And I wanted a school that was very diverse. I wanted to go to a place where not everybody looked like me, not everybody acted like me, and not everybody came from the same place. And I wanted an opportunity to play football and get a great education. And Earlham really ticked off all the boxes. And I don't regret that at all. It was fantastic. Some of the best years of my life being a student athlete here, growing and learning a lot and doing a lot here. So.
That's Can you describe your experience with football at Earlham College?
Yeah. I mean, there was certainly a lot of disappointment in terms of success. We won 12 games in 4 years. You know, my first 3 years here, we were 2-8. The year before I got here, they were 3-7. And every freshman comes in, you remember this experience too. Oh, well, we're going to make a difference. Mm-hmm. We're going to change it around. And you find that culture change is not something that you yourself are solely responsible for, but you solely are a part of it. And you want to certainly share in the appropriate example. And you're learning and growing as a freshman. There was good guys here, good talent. I thought there were great coaches here. It's just didn't work out for a few years. We talked a lot about accountability and ownership going into my senior year, and there was a group of us that were very committed to that. They developed the Unity Council. You remember me talking to you guys about that. So I was a part of the inaugural class of that. And so in the Unity Council, we kind of came up with some credos. Our head coach had the whole, "If I don't, we won't." And you remember me passing that around to you guys. Just keeping some legacy things that Frank Carr had kept alive. And we kind of really adopted that, did some good things, had some good talent come in our junior and sophomore class that was really impactful to our team, and we were able to go 6-4. If we had figured some better things out, we might have been 7-3, but but it was a good year that year, and it kind of made up for some of the other years, as you knew that you had to go through those tough times and those losses to learn how to win, how to do it as a team, and how to do it the right way. So had a lot of good times. My experience with football was great. I love the guys. I love the teammates I had. I love the getting up at 6 a.m. and then trying to go to class and trying to go through the day and coming back at 4 o'clock for meetings and film. I was obsessed with it. And I loved Earlham, and I still do love Earlham, and I loved Earlham football. So my experience was great.
And you're actually getting into my next point, which I was going to bring up, is talk about the experience outside of just wins and losses. And I think a lot of people, look at Earlham's history in football, and you look at the numbers, it obviously doesn't say Earlham's a very good football school, but I think everybody has an experience just outside of what it says in the win-loss column. What was your experience like?
As a player or as a coach?
We'll go player. We're getting to the coaching.
Yeah, as a player, my experience was great, because what I learned was that although Earlham hadn't been successful as a football school, Earlham was real successful as a football family. It was fantastic as a football family. I mean, there were people that were living out of the country and in various parts of the world that would tune in every week online or write in to figure out how the team was doing. And all of our little traditions and idiosyncrasies that we had that kind of made us our own group and made us a family were really special. And I completely appreciate that. I think any of our alumni that played definitely in the Frank Carr era can connect and appreciate that too. But we try to connect that to the previous areas too, because there's a lot of success prior to Coach Carr being here developing that familial foundation. There was a lot of success for the program. I mean, Roman football is still undefeated against Notre Dame, you know, so there was some really great things about it on the field, but absolutely some tremendous things about it off the field.
Go through your 4 years after you graduate Earlham College. How did you end up getting a position to where you get to come back and coach the alma mater?
So I graduated, and I was an HDSR major. And I really enjoyed how that tied in a lot of my passions and interests academically and vocationally. And I thought I was going to go into social work or at least high school guidance counseling or something of that nature. And part of that requirement for the major for our comprehensive final exams was to do a problem analysis. In addition to that, you have to do some type of human service work, field study at that time. And I chose to do work with juvenile delinquency. Uh-huh. So I went up in the end of my junior year, because I was kind of late to the game with HDSR, so I didn't get the field study in. And my sophomore year, I went up at the end of my junior year back home and talked to juvenile corrections, and got with them and did a brief interview to be kind of an inline guard, someone that's there and kind of monitoring the students and making sure they don't get out of their detention facility or whatnot. They looked at some of my experiences that I'd had, and this is before Epic, but Earlham's been doing Epic things since its inception. And I had a lot of experience with behavioral and conduct disorder, working with State Hospital here in town, doing volunteer work with Wernley, doing work with Richmond High School's guidance department. And they really liked my experiences. And instead of offering a position in line with corrections, they had created this new halfway house for court-appointed social advocacy, CASA. And they were allowing juvenile delinquents ages 14 to 18 to live there as they kind of acquiesced their way back into normal life. And they had a lot of issues. You get the case files on these kids and just read their stories and hear their background and what they've experienced. You can see how they had gotten to this situation. Uh-huh. And I really had a heart for that, and I really enjoyed that. And I learned that I liked that a lot at the time over the summer when I did that internship. Came back, did my whole presentation over it. As I was leaving that summer, the director said that we're impressed with you. You've got a great acumen for this. We want to hire you full time. So when you graduate, the job is yours. And so I was excited about having a job back home, an opportunity doing something I love, working with kids. I thought it was great. I always wanted to coach. I thought maybe I could do that on the side back home at my alma mater. That was a standing order from my high school coach to become the AD. That anytime you want to come back, you and your brother, you guys can help with the program. So I thought that'd be cool. So I graduated from Earlham, went back home to do that, and did it for about 3 months and really got burned out. I mean, it was, it's hard work. And you know me, I make connections with young people, and I really bought into these kids, and then you see them have recidivism and other things going on, and it just, I didn't think I could work with juvenile delinquents for 12 hours a day, but I thought maybe I could do it for 2 to 4, so I'll go into coaching. So it so happened that our track coach was one of my dear friends. I ran track and field here as well, was looking for an intern assistant and couldn't find anybody. And he called me up and asked if I had any interest in the position. You know, my fiance was still down here as a student. I really wasn't taking off with the court appointed social advocacy thing. So about doing that for about 3 months, I said, yeah, I'll come back to Rome. And I took about a $20,000 pay cut and came back, and I was an assistant coach here. But I loved it. I loved every minute of it. I started off as assistant track, assistant cross country, and I did that for 2 years in Earlham's athletic intern program. And then after the second year, the AD, who was the head coach when I was in college for football, helped to restructure a position that they created at Earlham that was head track and field assistant football in conjunction with the head cross country track coach, who said I could do it under one condition, that I would stay. You know, he would give up the head track position, and he never really gave it up. He pretty much ran the whole show while he taught me, because I was still 22 at this time, you know, 23, 24. He taught me how to be a head coach, how to recruit, how to do a lot of things, and I'm really grateful for him. That guy's name is Pat Thomas. He's in the Earlham Athletics Hall of Fame as well. So,
side note, spoke to one of Kevin Hanley.
Yeah,
he's going to be coming on the show. We're scheduling the time right now.
Got a lot of stories on
Going to his gym to see how he mentors the kids and all that kind of stuff.
Don't ask him about me. Kevin's like a brother to me. He was a senior when I was a freshman and really mentored me and took my brother and I and so many others under his wing. He graduated and came back to Earlham and was an assistant football coach.
Yeah, you mentioned he coached you.
Assistant dean of admissions there and did a lot of recruitment for Earlham, multicultural recruitment coordinator, and just a great man and was in my wedding, one of my best friends.
Mm-hmm. So. Mentioned how you got the job, head coaching at Earlham. Talk about the feeling that you had when you got hired to be the head coach at Earlham.
For track and field or for football?
For football.
Oh, for football. So I did track and field head coach for about 12 years. And then the football opportunity became available in 2015. And I was elated. I was really, first of all, very honored that they considered me. And really even more honored that I was appointed to that position. And I felt very blessed by that, and then a tremendous weight of responsibility because of the state of things that we're in at that time, and trying to develop a plan, and it proved difficult in the end, but I was excited, I loved it, I was elated, it was like a dream come true, because you dream about getting the job that you always wanted, but not very many of us get to realize that, and having to realize that, that was fantastic, it was one of the highlights of my life.
That's leads to my next point. You talked about your experience as a player. Now, what was your experience like as a coach?
Oh, man. Coaching is the greatest thing that you can do. It's like teaching. It's like mentoring. It's like parenting. It's one of the greatest things you can do. What are the jobs that you never lose, right? Mm-hmm. If you're somebody's pastor, you're always Pastor so-and-so. If you're somebody's teacher, you're always Mr. or Mrs. So-and-so.
True, yeah.
Somebody's parent, you're always mom or dad, and if you're somebody's coach, you're always coach.
That is.
And it's a tremendous honor. I never took it lightly. I always loved it. I love the kids, cross-country, track, football, youth league stuff, whatever it was I was in. I felt really blessed and honored to do it.
Did it make it tougher because we weren't seeing the results of what we ultimately wanted in the end?
At first, yes. So before you arrived, it was really difficult because you feel this pressure to live up to the expectation of the alumni, to live up to the expectation of the students and their parents that you recruit, live up to the expectation of the administration at the college. They hired you to do a job, and you're not getting it done. But in the end, and this is probably why I no longer do that professionally, to me it became about so much more than wins and losses. It became about the process, inundating student athletes and people to the process and what this is. You know from your own experience the grind and the schedule and the workload that it can be to be a student athlete. How does one find joy in that? How does one find accountability? How does one extol the virtues of hard work, honest reflection on that hard work, what it means to have respect for the opportunity that so few ever get to do, and develop the kind of self-discipline that they not only use in a game to be successful, but they would use in life to be a successful coworker, to be a successful teammate, to be a successful co-parent, to be a successful person, as a good citizen, good human being. And then developing the passion of this game to translate to so many other passions. I talk to you guys all the time about it. If you have as much love for your literature class as you do for football, you're gonna get straight A's. If you have as much love for calculus as you do for football, you're gonna get straight A's. And how do you take those same passions, and maybe it's something you don't really like, but you can use the same energies and efforts to do well in that other area, that's only gonna enhance your life and your academic experience. The same 2 feet that would be on our field participating would be the same 2 feet that are in that classroom, learning and becoming an educated human being, the same 2 feet that are gonna go out and change the world. And it became more about that. It became more about making better teammates who became better brothers that in turn were better sons that became better husbands and better fathers, trying to change the world one guy at a time.
Gotcha. Was that how you were able to get student athletes to come to Earlham?
I hope so. I don't know. nobody says, not very many people wake up and say, I want to play for a winless team. Mm-hmm. And a lot of people, some of the guys we had wanted that challenge and wanted to go from worst to first, which I really respect that. That's something I would have wanted. Earlham Mount Union was national champs, and I could have been on the team. Earlham College was 3-7 with no prospectus for being national champs, but I wanted to be a part of a team, if that makes sense. So that was the message that I shared in recruiting. You can go to all these other schools that have rings. You can go to all these other schools that have 150, 180 guys. And, yeah, I guess that wins modern football games. Or you can come here and you can start. You can come here and you can play now. You can impact our program. There's a lot of programs that you know, you'll make a brief impact on. This is a program where not only you will impact the field and the team, but the college, the education, the experience will impact you the rest of your life as you continue as a lifelong learner. That was the message we were sending. And I just felt like I was passionate about it. I still am passionate about it. I'm passionate about what we do with students here, what we do with people, what we do with citizens of the world. I wanted every kid to have what I had, which was a great education, a great social experience, and a chance to play the game that I love. I didn't have to. Kevin will come on next week and tell you I had to wait a long time to play, but I didn't have to wait too long to play.
So, I mean, I could tell you personally, I think a lot of kids, maybe the first year came in with that mindset, and after a year, you know, that mindset just quickly left, and that's why a lot of kids transferred out of Earlham. I just don't think they could, you know, handle it no more. Mm-hmm. You know, you coached 4 years, correct?
I was a head coach here for four years. 4 seasons.
And, you know, the freshman class that mm-hmm. you brought in for your first year, mm-hmm. you know, about 20-something guys, yep. it only ends with three.
Yep.
And a lot of guys, you know, all they talk about is the record. And, you know, speaking to players who are still here, that do they wish they still play football? Of course. Sure. But, you know, I think you really got through them that it's, you know, it's more than just football. That it is about the education. I mean, Earlham does offer a really good education. And I also feel like, you know, a lot of guys didn't like being the butt of every joke here on campus. You know, we got football caught a lot of flack from a lot of teams, and that's nothing to hide, and really couldn't say nothing about it.
Right.
When did you find out that you weren't going to be able to coach the next season?
Well, I pretty much knew at the beginning of the final year that if things didn't turn around quickly, that I was going to be out of an opportunity to be the head football coach at Earlham College. It wasn't stated to me because we went through a multiple AD transition.
Yes.
In a short time in a year. So three different ADs with three different statements. All three had very different ways of expressing that losing is not good and continuing this path is not good for your career or for the college. So I had an idea that if we didn't win a majority of the games, no one gets to be 0-40 and stay a head coach. No one gets to be 1-39 and stay as a head coach, or 2-38. So I don't know if a 5-5 season would have allowed for me to continue or the program to continue. It was really more about having a meeting with the administration and discussing my personal goings on with my wife's health and how unfair it was to our student athletes. For the first time, things had gotten to a point where it was more out of control than in control on my part. And so I was having to shove the majority of the workload on the assistant coaches for recruiting, for day-to-day practice scheduling, for meetings, all of this as my wife went through some pretty rough times and us getting transferred to Cleveland Clinic and their care being 5 hours away. It was really hard to administer the team. So the conversation started probably the last 2 weeks of the season where I developed with our athletic director. There's going to have to be, I know something's going to be done. I'd like for something to be done as painless as possible to my family, to the student athletes. Are there opportunities to transition? What can we do? I repeated myself. No one gets to be 2-38 or 1-39 because I was optimistic about winning the last two games.
Of course.
I always felt like we could win. And I know our record indicated otherwise, but I honestly and wholeheartedly believe in our coaching staff, believe in our student athletes, and believe in the school and this community. And so whether I was blind or an idiot for that, and now I'm proven wrong, but I went into it, and then I stand by that. And if we brought it back tomorrow and they allowed me, which will never happen, to coach it again, I would believe that we could win. I just would.
Of course.
But anywho, we started that conversation, and it worked out that some opportunities were available. And they put the ball in my court to make a decision. And I made the decision the week of the last game. And so you guys pretty much knew what was going to happen. I knew probably Monday night or Tuesday night. And I think we announced it to the – no, when did we announce it to the team?
We announced it Thursday.
Thursday before the last game, yes. Right? So I knew Monday or Tuesday of that week. I knew Monday, and then I told the staff on Tuesday, and we made the announcement Thursday.
Why choose to make the announcement before the game rather than after?
I didn't know if I was going to be back for the last game with my wife.
I got you.
I didn't know if I was going to be back before the last game with my. I didn't really want to make that announcement. I wanted to make the announcement at our banquet. That was my intention. But it seemed apropos to those around me that we notify the kids earlier.
And the story about your wife we'll get into in just a few moments. But yeah, we know the team finds out 2 days before the final game, and everybody was pretty distraught about the news. And then we go into the final game, and I didn't even know he was going to do it till I saw it on the field. But my fellow offensive lineman Lou Brake comes out for the final game wearing your jersey number that you wore when you attended Earlham. Yeah. Did you have any idea he was going to do that?
No clue. And no clue. I looked out and I was like, who's 57? I thought we gave 57 to the kid that quit. The kid quit. How did he get on the bus? You know, I'm looking for Coach Spurgeon to say, how did. And then I realized it was Luke, and it was pretty emotional for me.
Yeah, what, talk about, you know, what went through your mind, you know, what the feeling was when you saw that, how much you know your players cared about you. You know, he wore that jump number in honor of you coaching your final game.
Yeah, I think of every student that I've ever coached, even the ones that didn't like me or didn't feel like we had a great relationship, as my own kid. And I try to treat every player like I would treat my own children, my daughter and my son. And to see that, it was really impactful. It was very emotional for me, and it made the experience much more surreal when it dawned on me, this is the last time I'll coach college football. I don't know if it is the last. I was astonished to get job offers after I resigned, which really
we'll get into that.
I didn't think anybody, so that says a lot about those other people, I guess. Maybe they don't know, but I was astonished to get job offers after, because I was under the impression I'd never get to coach college again, and obviously may not ever coach again. So.
Well, before we get into that, I can tell you from a player, that game just felt different.
Yeah.
Even no matter what the final score says, like even as we were losing, it felt different than the other nine games that I was able to partake in.
Yeah.
You know, you talk about the shock of getting coaching offers, but even after your first year of coaching, you know, 0-10 season, you still were voted Coach of the Year, correct?
Yeah.
You know, talk about, you know, were you completely shocked getting Coach of the Year having an 0-10 season?
Yeah, I was. I was stunned. And to this day, I still don't feel like I deserve it. And I hope that message came across to the people. I never think of, like, someone as being Coach of the Year. I know it takes a village, right?
Of course, yeah.
And I had a really great staff. I had guys that were really committed to me and really committed to, more importantly, to our kids. And I wanted American Football Coaches Association and our conference and the media to know that it was because of, you know, Robert Lee and Chuck Arrett and you know, Elijah Ferguson and Dyrell Roberts and Coach Davis and all those people that helped, you know, with Earlham football. Coach Fisher, they held the thing up while I'm running around like a chicken with my head cut off. And I think about now what I did that first year, and I can't fathom how I even did it. You know, we were having practices and morning practices. I didn't miss a single practice that year. I missed one game because my wife had the brain seizure.
Yeah, we'll get into that.
But I didn't miss a single practice. And the coaching staff I had, they were running and doing everything. And, you know, sometimes I felt like I was just a fly on the wall, but I felt like I had to be present, had to be there. Kudos to the other gentlemen that coached the other programs in the league. Great class, wonderful guys. Some people had mentioned to me that Earlham College doesn't belong in the Heartland Collegiate Athletic Conference, particularly for football. I didn't know about all that. I just knew that the individuals that I was lucky to be around as fellow head coaches were first class, tremendous human beings, great people. And I think it says a lot more about them than it ever could say about me. It says more about my staff, says more about the other coaches than it ever could say about me. I'm just the guy who was praying that I put one foot in front of the other and the ground would still be there. I was just a guy who was hoping that his wife would survive, that I could, you know, have her to see our children grow and do well, and hoping that I could continue to do the job that I love the most. That's who I was. Everybody else put in a lot of hard work. They put in a lot of effort. So kudos to the league for recognizing our assistance.
So after that final game, we find out 2-3 days after that the program was going to be suspended for a season due to obviously the record and for what they say safety issues of us only having about 40 players or maybe even less than that. What was you, how did you feel about that, you know, having been a player at Earlham, what football at Earlham meant to you in your experience as a coach and as a player?
I went through a multitude of emotions. I'll just be honest with everyone listening to this right now. I was very depressed about the whole outcome. I mean, you're talking about one of the lowest points in my life. You know, my wife is battling for her health. My kids are adjusted really well, but they have their own struggles with everything that's been going on at home. And in my professional life, I'm not very successful by the world standards and by the convention of the scoreboard. And then I have to go in front of a group of young men that I love dearly and tell them that I'm really bad at this. I got to stop doing it, you know, and I love you, but I'm hurting you. That's hard to admit, and that's hard to say. And it was very surreal. And the day that I found out, the same time you guys did, just really crushed my soul, crushed my heart. Many ways I understand why the college made that decision. In many ways, I, for obvious reasons, cannot agree with it. Just full disclosure, if they would tell me that I could still do it, I could still recruit kids, I could still coach, and we can still keep doing it, I would still keep doing it. And that's a little selfish on my part, because that's probably not fair to our student athletes that with my current situation, not being able to be around, and it's definitely not fair to the college because I'm not living up to my end of the bargain by promising success and not delivering.
And even after you found out, what did it tell you about yourself that your phone is still blowing up with coaching job offers from a lot of programs that you've either faced or haven't faced?
You know, I don't know what it said. I don't know. I don't know. I think a few of those individuals that were interested in interviewing me for positions, I don't know. I told them I was humbled. I told them I was honored. I respectfully had to decline because of the situation. Uh-huh. I don't want to, if I'm not going to put my own players and the kids I love dearly through that situation, I definitely don't want to put kids I don't know in other schools and other institutions. I never wanted to coach anywhere else but Earl. I never wanted to go to any other school. I never wanted to go to any higher level. I never wanted to go any lateral moves. I wanted to win here, wanted to be here, wanted to see success here and proliferate all of the history and meaning and things that were Earlham football so that people would have what I had. I just felt like what I had was the best thing ever. What I had was the most fantastic experience, the most fantastic time, the greatest friends, the greatest fraternity and teammates that anybody could ever have, and many of them still are great friends, and even the ones that are real upset with me that we don't have football now, I still love them dearly. It was just awesome, and I wanted everybody to have that.
Yes, sir.
I really wanted everybody to have that, and I couldn't think of it anywhere else. So it's hard for me to entertain other jobs, and I had great men show some interest in me being positioned as assistant coach and things of that nature. And it just wouldn't be fair to those individuals who deserve a better coach, wouldn't be fair to those students who deserve a better coach, and definitely wouldn't be fair to my family and the situation we're in right now.
Yes, sir. All right, Coach. You've brought it up a few times, but we're going to get into it in a little bit, the whole situation with your wife. You know, people around here know a lot what's going on. They may not know everything. You know, what has been going on with not just your wife, but your family?
Oh, man, it's, I don't even know where to begin. The major thing with us and what I think we're known for, I know what I'm known for. You just got to troll the internet. But what we're known for, my wife and I, our family, is her health crisis, her battle. And that was really tough when that happened, 2014. So I was the head track and field assistant football coach, and my wife was head basketball coach. And we had a family, and then I coached football up until 2012, and then took a brief break to do more. Since we're both being head coaches, it was hard to find time. So I just stuck with track and field in 13 and 14. And in 14, around March, she had been battling severe endometriosis for ever since our kids were born, for years. And partial hysterectomy was the answer, we thought, and that didn't work as well. So it was recommended that she have a full hysterectomy. She had a full hysterectomy, about 2 weeks in recovery or a week in recovery from that, and just go home. It was all well done. She started to develop pancreatitis. And if you don't know what pancreatitis is, it's an inflammation irritation of the pancreas. which is a very sensitive organ, and it's in a position in your abdominal cavity that just causes excruciating pain. And a lot of things can cause it. Trauma to the abdomen from an automobile accident or blunt force, or excessive consumption of alcohol. And I know that she doesn't drink, so we were trying to figure out what caused it. We went to IU Health, met with some specialists. They did a few procedures trying to expand parts of the pancreas and take some of the issue away. But they mentioned to us that once it's one of those organs that once it gets angry and starts malfunctioning, it can go south really fast. So fast forward to the end of the year, multiple pancreatic attacks. IU is not really able to isolate where they're coming from because she doesn't have a lot of the other markers that would cause it. They send us to Mayo Clinic. So we go all the way up to Mayo Clinic in Rochester, Minnesota, 10-hour drive, and we spend about a month up there where I'm away from coaching track, I'm away from the school, I'm away from recruiting, and I'm there for a month with her, off and on, pancreatic attack every other day. And they expressed to us, the more attacks you have, the more scar tissue that develops in the pancreas, the more your propensity for pancreatic cancer, which has one of the lowest survival rates. And that's really got us frightened. They determined through testing and finding some other conditions that she has that it was genetic. And so just the trauma from the partial hysterectomy and the whole hysterectomy abdominal surgeries ticked off the gene, and it went into tailspin and pancreatitis. So we spend the remainder of that year trying to figure out how we're going to deal with this. And every day you're worried about, you know, pancreatic cancer becoming a problem. Well, through a friend of a friend, we're recommended to Cincinnati. And we discovered that there's about four places that do this fantastic procedure at that time where they remove your pancreas and extract the islet of Langerhorn cells that produce the insulin and re-inject those into the hepatic vein of your liver, and your liver now functions as your pancreas. So you're not really a diabetic. You're a diabetic, but you're not diabetic. Uh-huh. And you don't have pancreatitis anymore. So a bunch of stuff happened between then, from bowel obstructions to spinal surgeries and leaks and all this, that we finally get the total pancreatectomy with autologous islet cell transplantation. Fantastic doctor in Cincinnati, Syed Ahmad, and his staff, and they do their whole deal with that. And it's about an 8-hour surgery, and they remove your gallbladder, your pancreas, your spleen, part of your stomach, part of your small intestines, and kind of rehook everything. A lot of people don't necessarily regain digestion after that. The hope is that you will, but a lot of people don't. And she was unfortunately one of those people that didn't. She had an issue with an intrathecal pain pump that had existed before the surgery. They removed it, left a hole in her spine. She lost a lot of spinal fluid. They put her in the hospital here. And by then, I've accepted the head coaching job at Earlham. And she's in the hospital here. And we're waiting for the first home game in 2015 against DePaul University, which is where Luke Brake goes now. Great Coach Lynch, great man. Her mom calls me before the game and says that she's had an infection go into her brain and that she's seizing and is unconscious in a coma, and they're going to lifeline her to IU Methodist Neuro Hospital. This is happening right when I'm talking to the head coach at DePaul before the game, and I had to just tell him that I got to go. And I explained 30 seconds the situation to him, and we had built this contingency in because I knew my wife was sick, so I told the staff and the kids, and everyone knows that Coach Lee is in charge when I'm not around, so he knew how to run the game and all that. And I just got in the car, and I thought she was already at IU, so I got halfway past Newcastle before I found out that she was still in Reed at Richmond. So I had to do a U-turn on the highway and almost got T-boned by a semi. I'll never forget that. That's one of those movie experiences. He wasn't happy. He showed me his favorite finger after that.
But, I'm sure he did.
I sped back to the hospital, got to see her just as they were loading her up with a helicopter. And it was just brutal. She was unconscious, nonsensical. And they flew her out, and I got in the car with one of my pastors, and he was driving me to the hospital. And it's such a surreal experience when you see the person that you love most in that condition, and you know that you can't do anything. And I'm looking out the window as we're following a helicopter down the highway, and I'm thinking, if that thing lands, is she going to be alive? You know, I didn't know. And what do I tell my kids? What do I tell our players? What do I tell my coaches? Do I even, you know, all these things run through your mind. Worst case scenario, she survived that. We spent 100 days in the hosptital at Methodist, and it was posterior reversible encephalitis and swelling in the brain. And so she had to relearn some short-term, long-term memory things, learn how to eat and kind of walk and use a restroom and all that again. She came, once the brain starts healing, you get it all back. But It was like 51st dates the first week and a half, because she would wake up and I'd be like, you know who I am? And she could only say her birthday, because that's what they have you say before they give you medication. She's like, 3/27/81. I'm like, that's not me. That's your birthday. And she said Abraham Lincoln was the president and all that. So it was, we can laugh about it now, but it was a really scary time. And so she would wake up and I'd have to retell her the story of what happened and the emotion that comes with that, knowing that you almost died. It was pretty freaky stuff. But that led into us finding Cincinnati. We got done with Cincinnati. They did a great job. She never got digestion. So people there recommended Cleveland Clinic. And so that's kind of the area you came around. So we went to Cleveland Clinic and worked with their gastroenterology, worked with their motility specialist, and determined that the best thing to do might be removal of the colon. So we do a colectomy that might help get everything going and potentially become a candidate for intestinal transplant, just the small intestines. It didn't work as well as we had hoped. There were some good things out of it. Cleveland Clinic's a great place, great care. But in some of our travels and our time, everybody kept talking about IU again. IU. They have a multivisceral transplant. And I'm like, what is multivisceral? And it's like, it's not just intestines. They give you a liver, a stomach, a pancreas, small intestines, large intestines. I'm like, we ain't doing that. We just lost all that stuff. But my wife thought about it. It's the first time in this journey that people have talked about putting stuff in instead of taking stuff out. And we end up, you know, everything happened with football and going on sabbatical. Mm-hmm. We took a trip down to Florida just to be together as a family. And we're down there and we're at SeaWorld and disaster strikes. She starts having internal bleeding, which she's prone to do. And because she has connective tissue disorder, doesn't heal well. And she's bleeding out of her stomach tube and gastric tubes in Florida. And my kids just want to see the dolphins. And, you know, she's trying to be a trooper and fight through it. I'm like, we got to get help. And she's pale as a ghost. And so we finally get her sent to the hospital. And there's a surgeon there that's going to go and kind of work on some of the bleeds endoscopically. And he says to her, why haven't you tried IU? And she goes, are you from Indiana? He goes, no, it's just where we send a lot of our patients that have gastric problems because they're one of the best. He's like the fifth medical professional inside that year that told us to try IU. So at that point, we got on the list. We went up there, and they accepted us and talked to us about the procedure. And she seemed all in for it. And we're thinking we're going to wait better part of a year. So it's been 2014. It's now 2019. You know, we're going to wait one more year or two to get these organs, and then we'll do the transplant. We get listed probably about 6.5 weeks ago. We get listed, and within 36 hours, they procured organs.
Wow.
So we have been going for 5 years, and then within 36 hours, all of a sudden, stuff's getting done. So that was kind of another sign to us. The surgical team was great. The doctors there are great. The care we had the first time there was great. Dr. Fogel, all of our doctors have been wonderful. And so Dr. Mangus and his team have done the surgery. She's now in the process of recovering and healing. It's not an easy process. Any little thing can set you back. But we're used to that. I think these previous years have steeled our resolve and taught us how to, maybe we had to go through all that so that we'd be really good at going through this. And so we're well trained in it. And, you know, a couple weeks in the hospital, he said, no, you'll probably end up staying anywhere from 60 to 80 days. We're like, that's it? He was like, you've stayed in the hospital longer? I'm like, yeah. So she's there right now, convalescing, doing well. She's one of the first people to come out of the surgery. It only took 9 hours. It's supposed to take 12 to 15. Wow. She came out of it in 9. An hour after surgery, she demanded to be extubated. She wrote on a little chart, you know, get this expletive thing out of my throat. Typically, they're intubated for a few days. She demanded to be extubated. She was extubated a couple hours after that. And then later that day, sat up on the side of the bed and then stood up, which is rare. They say patients don't do that. And she's been walking ever since, and she's up to the point now where she walks the entirety of the hospital. She's just ready to get out. So, but, you know, there's some scares with rejection, some mm-hmm. scares with fevers, and we want to make sure food stays in and stays down. But she has no gastric external tube. She has no PIC line, which is the big thing that can get infected and go to the brain again. That was our big worry. She has no jejunal tube. She just got a nice scar. But she's had that scar, and they went through it again, so it's aesthetically the same. And a lot of determination. She has a lot of determination. So very proud of her. I couldn't imagine going through this with anybody else. She's super tough.
She's in Indianapolis right now?
Indianapolis right now. And it's been hard. She misses coaching. That was her passion. She was supposed to be a doctor. That's why I married her. And she ended up being a coach. And now we're both broke. But she was so good at it. And she was able to do a lot of the things I wasn't able to do as a coach. And She was an expert recruiter, expert strategist, and worked really hard at it. I'm very proud of her. Had some great assistants, and was in the process of considering the current women's coach as an assistant when we thought she'd be back, and that didn't work out. But I'm so grateful that Earlham hired Coach Watson, who will be on next time, to be the coach, because she kind of embodies the same energy and intellect and spirit and work ethic that my wife had. And I think that's great for the program. I think the alumnus will come back and remember that and see that in her. And she's done, I think, a really great job with those student athletes, and excited to see their season this year. And Melissa's a big fan and follows her. And they stay in contact about the season and team. And they go to lunch a lot and never invite me because I know I eat everything. But she's been a great friend and great support.
Did she know about the story when she got hired here?
Yes, she did. So she played in the league.
She graduated at Hanover, right?
She played in the league and knew of my wife and knew of the situation. And the league had been great. Heartland Collegiate Conference has been fantastic. They put on benefits for my wife and I. They've, you know, done so much stuff, you know, honoring us. It's just really special family.
Great. Another subject for tomorrow.
Yeah. Yeah, they're good friends.
Yeah.
And she's from Fort Wayne, so she knows about God City, too. So
I'll bring that up.
Yeah.
You met your wife on campus, right?
Yeah.
I've heard the story, and it's actually a very interesting story. Do you want to say it?
Which version did you hear?
I heard walking in the AWC. Yeah.
It's not that. I mean, everybody else has these fantastic Earlham stories about how they met their spouse, you know. And mine is just, I was actually talking to another girl that was working the front desk at the Athletics and Wellness Center, and she was coming out of the training room past the weight room, and I was basically in her way, and she did kind of a fancy dribble maneuver to get around me, and that kind of intrigued me. I was impressed. And then she spent the rest of her career not paying attention to me. So,
okay.
But eventually I won her over. I was always impressed with her determination. She was very much into what she was into. She was into basketball and being successful at that. Was a conference defensive player, team defensive player. Was a team captain since she was a sophomore. She was very much into her education. She worked very hard, good GPA, trying to get into med school. So our dates consisted of me going to her room and skipping my homework and watching her do her homework.
Sounds fun.
But she's great people.
Do you think she knows how much of an inspiration she is?
No, she does. She does, because, you know, and I hope you don't ever have to go through this, but when you're in that fight, you don't know, like, you're inspiring people. You don't know that you're encouraging others. You don't know that things catch on or trend or whatever. You're just doing everything you can to get through each day. I mean, the nurses are always impressed with her pain tolerance. You know, they'll come in and say, what's your pain scale on 1 to 10? And she'll say 6, and I know it's an 8. You know, but she doesn't want to be perceived as weak, doesn't want to be perceived as taking too much of their energy and time, and she thinks she can do a lot of this on her own, which we found you can't. But she doesn't consider herself an inspiration. She just considers herself a mom and a spouse that's trying to be there for her kids and her husband.
Because, I mean, if to everybody who knows the story or even knows a little bit about it, for somebody to fight like that for five and a half years and still continuing to fight to this day, and as much as she has gone through.
But yeah,
I mean, that is unfathomable.
I think, you know, when these things happen, it's really easy for you to say, Lord, why me? And we came to determination early on in this battle that our statement was going to have to be, why not me? And if we can set an example for other people of how to endure and have perseverance and have faith, and you know, a lot of couples don't make it through this kind of thing. And we've been stronger than ever throughout all of it, almost to a detriment. But it's never a detriment when you're that close to one another. And it's just been so much has been out of this. You don't know how strong you can be until you have to be that strong. And to be able to keep going the way she does is an inspiration to all of us, myself included. And, you know, when I'm having a bad day or I'm depressed about everything that's going on with her and everything that's going on in our lives and the stuff that happened with football, I remember that, you know, she wasn't supposed to wake up and she did. And she wasn't supposed to stand up and she did. And she wasn't supposed to be walking and she does. And it is inspirational. She won't accept that. She doesn't think of herself an inspiration, but it is. And I'm glad that people get a chance to see it.
So we talked about what happened and what's still going on currently with your wife. How did the kids react to everything?
It was scary. So my son wasn't really old enough. They were 3 and 5 when it started. And he kind of wasn't old enough to know everything that was going on. My daughter's always been pretty much ahead of the curve and very emotional, and she really keyed into it. And one of the hardest conversations in my life is when my wife's in the hospital unconscious, and you know, your five-year-old little girl looks at you and says, "Is mommy gonna die?" That's the stuff that nightmares were built out of. And you know, honestly, I was like, "I don't know," you know. And then I had to come back and build. I was like, "I don't know isn't good enough for a five-year-old who loves her mother and idolizes her and wants to be her every second of the day. How do I?" I said, "You know, mommy's just not well right now, but you know that your mother's very strong and she's very determined. And if anyone can make it through this, she can. And we just got to support her and be there for her and keep loving on her and make her feel better. And we got to keep praying." And it's so cute to hear. Little kids have the best prayers because they're honest prayers. They're sincere prayers. And they mean it. They're not jaded like adults, and they don't lose their faith the way that we do. And so it was really special. And a lot of people don't know this, but one of my biggest inspirations has been my children, like how they've handled all this. They've been fantastically resilient. Kids are much more resilient than we think. And they've been so resilient that it's helped me, like their energy, their enthusiasm, their positivity, their belief that mom's gonna be okay, that it's gonna be okay, that everything's gonna work. When I was at my lowest with all this and all the football, if I didn't have my kids, I don't know like what or how we make it, how we do it. They just, I after it happened, I went out back and my son was like, "Dad, let's throw the football around." And we're throwing it back and forth and all that. And I realized he can't catch, he's worse than I am. And Alex Painter Admissions will tell you about the gator. I'm throwing it to him and I'm teaching him how not to be like daddy, how to catch it with a diamond. And it dawned on me, I talked to a bunch of other kids for years about how to catch a football before I talked to my own son about how to do it. And so things happen for a reason, but having the opportunity, the time to be with my kids has been special through all this. And having them with us and by our side as we go through this struggle as a family has been special too. They're very, very strong individuals.
How's the transition from, you know, them being 3 and 5 to now?
Well, they've grown up with it. So my son hasn't known anything different. He's going to kind of grow up and know that his mom has always had a health crisis. And he'll look back at, they look back at our family albums. And my wife was very meticulous and kept a lot of photos before she got sick. And they see her running races and they see her playing in 303 tournaments and they see her coaching and, you know, more fuller framed and more fit and muscular. And they had no idea that, you know, mommy was this bastion of health before all this happened. And so that's kind of neat for him to go back and see that she hadn't always been a patient, hadn't always been sick. I think he respects her strength even more now than seeing her as an athlete. You know, I think he respects the kind of resilience that it takes to survive something like this. My daughter is the one we worried about the most because she had always been keyed into things, particularly emotional. She has a very good emotional intelligence, and she's responded really well. She works with a counselor at her school, or did for a number of years, but doesn't right now. But she's responded really well, been really positive. You know, we're very involved with our faith in our church, and those people have stood by us from day one. I think they always will. They're like family to me. We have a small group, and they were just up visiting the other day at the hospital, and so they've kind of helped raise our kids and kept them going too. And without my in-laws, man, my wife's parents are just rock stars. They're just tremendous people. And you don't just marry an individual, you marry their family, you know.
Of course.
Her family has just been amazing and helped to raise our kids. And the people in Wayne County, you know, another reason not to take other jobs, not to leave Richmond, is everybody in Wayne County and LifeSpring Church and the things I'm involved in have just taken such good care of us, have just been there for us throughout all of this. Can't imagine myself being anywhere else.
How did the story end up becoming national attention? The story made ESPN, made other national platforms. How did that come up?
Mitch Blankenspor was our sports information director at the time. And local media had kind of taken interest in this. So there's a gentleman who was our kind of a well-known writer, Mike Lopresti. I don't know if you had a chance to meet Mike yet.
I don't think I have.
Expert journalist, well-known writer, done sports columns for USA Today and other stuff. he's good friends with the entirety of the athletic department, the entirety of Earlham College. He kind of caught wind of the story, knew of my wife as a coach.
Why am I just now hearing this, man?
we got to get you hooked up with
him. Yes, sir.
Fountain of knowledge, and I know this is a profession you're very interested in. He'd be a great person to talk to. Be good for one of these podcasts if you can get him.
Yeah.
He came and interviewed me for the Indianapolis Business Journal, and I just kind of laid it all on the line. Well, that led to the story getting in the Indianapolis paper, which led to American Football Coaches Association wanting to do something, which led to D3 Football wanting to do a web article, which led to Dan Dockage from ESPN Radio doing an interview, which led to Beyond the Ball podcast, which led to another podcast. Well, by then, everybody that's connected to sports had kind of got something out of this. Well, then the story comes up that we haven't won a game, that my wife's got this health struggle, and that we were voted Coach of the Year. Well, then ESPN was like, what's that? So they reached out to Mitch, and he started working on some things, and he's now sports information at Wilmington College. New dad, so congratulations, Mitch and Janelle. And so he did a great job of liaising all that, and we met with our marketing team, and ESPN came over and asked if they could do the story, and I agreed entirely and made sure it was all right with the college, and it ran. And it ran well, and took off on Facebook, and I think went viral. Is that what the kids say? I don't know what that means.
Yeah, that's a well-known statement.
The best part that I enjoy about it, in fact, I just saw it again today. We lost the DVD that they gave us, so I haven't seen it in years. And it was on our old DVR, and when we transferred services, we lost it too. So I haven't seen it. But it came up on my Facebook feed because a friend of our family had recorded it live on Facebook. And it said 3 years ago, and it came up, and I watched it today, which was a mistake because it's a bit of a tearjerker. I'm in my office crying. People are like, you all right? It's like, I'm cutting onions in here. Y'all get out. But my favorite part of that is when they show highlights of my wedding, and you see my brother in the background crying, his big soft self. Because he was emotionally moved by the wedding. It was really cool. That's one of my favorite things. I always like to pause it at that part and point it to him. But it was tough, and it was surreal. You don't ever expect to be on national TV, and you don't ever expect to be on national TV for that reason. But I think it was honest, and Gene Wojciechowski is amazing. If you watch the game day stuff, they just did another piece a couple weekends ago. It was just amazing, the stuff they do. And Aaron Johnson, the producer, and Terry Mayday is my guy. I don't know if he even remembers. Terry probably remembers me. He stopped over a couple of years. He had the film crew. They're out of Chicago. Just, they were fantastic people, and they check in on us every now and then. They send text messages and see how we're doing. It's just ESPN, and I can't thank them enough because of that. They made, my wife's cousin had made it's like a GoFundMe thing, and I asked her not to do it. But they had their own health crisis. Their son had severe epilepsy and tons of medical bills, and they were at Cleveland Clinic forever. And someone had done it for her, and she said, I'm going to pay it forward. I want to do it for you guys. So she set the whole thing up, and she would update it weekly with blogs and stuff about Melissa and her progress and her journey. And Gene made a national announcement about it. And once it went on ESPN, people from, like, California and Texas and New York and all over were donating. And, I mean, we incurred very little medical debt because of that. It was fantastic. Wow. It was fantastic what they did. Because we had lost my wife's salary in this process. And she was on disability, so that gave us something. But we had lost her salary. And so a lot of people were like, yeah, man, you got promoted to head football coach, which kind of offended me. It's like, I was already a head coach. I didn't get promoted. You trying to say that I was terrible as a head track coach? Which I was. But anyway, even though I got a different pay scale in that, being the head football coach, just with benchmarks and all, still less than what we made as a family when we were both head coaches. So all that really helped, and I'm so grateful for Deborah and everything that she does. And I love my wife's family. They're awesome, man. Awesome.
So what did it feel like to you and Melissa, and just your whole family in general, knowing the whole world, or the whole country and possibly the world, knew about your wife's story?
She hated it. She hated it. She didn't like seeing herself on film because she doesn't want to be portrayed as weak. Mm. And I don't think she understands that you're seen as strong when you can, you know, they wheeled her out there. She was very, not frail, but still really beat up from the surgery and the procedures and not digesting. And she was battling something that day. And they interviewed her anyway. And she hated that she was in a wheelchair. She hated that she was on TV looking like that and all that. But she didn't understand, like, what we were talking about earlier, like, how that inspired people, like, what that means, like, to people in their daily living and all that. And so she didn't like her business being out there, but she's kind of grown accustomed to it because people ask. And they ask because they care, and they want to know, and they want to know how they can pray for us and what they can do. And, you know, right now, one of our neighbors has set up a meal train for us because she's over there dealing with the transplant. And so my kids have food every night, and I don't have to cook. My mother-in-law doesn't have to cook. My daughter doesn't have to cook. Great. But, you know, just a testament to the people in this community that are here locally that have provided for us, and some of them don't even know us. But we feel like we know them. And I remember saying this when the college hosted a benefit dinner for us in the cafeteria at Metz. I mean, Alexis, you're like the most amazing person. A lot of people can say they can count their true friends on one hand. I can't do that. I have a ton of people that are in my corner. So
yeah, Erlen has shown a lot of support. Formerly, so even a couple weeks ago at a soccer game, I saw the pumpkins.
Yeah.
Hope for Melissa.
Yeah.
You know, Erlen has still shown, you know, it's
coaches
support.
That have never met her, you know, women's lacrosse coach, has done, Lindsay did a video that they sent to her, and it just, man, it made my wife's day to get that. And, you know, Julie in athletics and everybody, the things that they do. Allison Franklin, I love you with all my heart. She's just been great setting up stuff for us. Like I said, the HCAC has been wonderful to us. Head coach at Mount St. Joe Women's Basketball, Dan, has just been a huge fan of Melissa's and she of his. And, you know, Mike Leonard, head coach of Franklin College, just football, just wonderful people that have really stepped up, done great things for us.
So, Coach, can I ask you, what made you take the head football coaching job at Erlen after, you know, the stuff started happening with your wife?
Well, I didn't at first. That's probably the first time that's public knowledge. I didn't think it was fair, for the same reasons I stepped down. I didn't think it would be fair to the kids to put them through all that too. But I also was hopeful that we'd get it figured out like within a year or two. And I think our AD was hopeful at the time, Mike Bergen. And it's a really hard thing, man, because the thing you always wanted to do is right there and you can do it. And it's hard to say no to. And they're gonna allow you to do it. I mean, they paid me to coach the game that I love the most around the kids that I love the most at the school that I love the most. I mean, people die without ever getting that opportunity. And I told my wife, I said, I can't do this. I'm not going to do this. What if it ends horribly? You know, what if I fail? I don't know if I could live with that. She said, I don't think you could live knowing that you didn't try. And I was like, okay. You got me there, you know, because she got to do it. She got to be the head women's basketball coach at her alma mater for her sport that she loves, around the kids that she loves, at the school that she loves. She was doing great as a teacher at a school north of here, Winchester Community, and just wonderful people up there, man. Just awesome programs, awesome education. Richmond, Winchester, this whole area has just been wonderful to us. And she was doing well, and they were worried that other places would get her for, like, high school basketball jobs or college basketball jobs. And she said the only one she would leave for is her own job. And within 5 years, the Erlen one came open, and she took it. So she knows that feeling, and she knows what it means to have done that. And it was a dream job. And I'd be lying to say I don't miss it every single day. I don't miss the guys, and I don't miss the coaches, and I don't miss the camaraderie and all that. It was fantastic. So I don't know how I could have said no to it a third time.
So, I don't remember if you told me this. Now you might have. Did she ever go to a game?
To me as a head coach, yes.
Yes.
Yeah, she was able to come to some, and I think the third year she was able to come to one or two as she was working on the transition to Cleveland Clinic. Yeah.
What was that first game like? The first game she was ever able to attend to view head coaching.
She couldn't stay long. She's seen me coach before, and she knows how we're entirely different. You know, she gets pretty heated, somewhat animated, and she can stomp the court with the best of them, but she's also very passionate. And she knows I'm passionate, but you've been around me. Mm-hmm. I'm not a yeller, not a screamer. I'm not going to run out on the field and do a whole bunch of other stuff. And so she can take it or leave it when I can coach or not. Her favorite part about football is the end of the game. And it kind of is mine too. We had this tradition, and I miss that more than anything. At the end of the game, my kids would run up to me and, you know, tell me, Daddy, you're still our hero, you know. And they'd done that since I was an assistant. You know, when we were winning games and I was an assistant, they would come up and say congratulations. And that's her favorite part. She takes all the photos then. And she's not a huge football fan, and I'm not a huge basketball fan. We're really completely opposite people, but we're passionate about each other's passions.
Gotcha. All right, so in continuing, we talked about the kids. And we talked about, you know, why you took the coaching job at Earlham, knowing everything that was going on, you know, with your wife and all that kind of stuff. I think the next question I was going to ask you was, after she recovers from the surgery you described, is this a permanent, like lifelong illness that your wife has?
It was prior to this, but after the transplant, where they put in 5 new organs, the future could look very bright. I mean, it's a different situation for us. So if we can get through this and she remains to be healthy and rebounds well and there's no rejection and continues to get stronger, she'll lead a normal, active, healthy life. She has a advocate that has gone through it, that she's become great friends with, that has been kind of our example, who's about 4.5 years out from her multivisceral transplant, and you wouldn't know that she had ever suffered or had any digestion or health issues. You would never know it. Was young, vibrant, leading a wonderful life, excellent human being, and just got engaged to be married and is, you know, doing great. So,
what do you think that day is going to be like where she gets discharged from the hospital and you are told that she's clear, that, you know?
It'll also feel surreal. I mean, this has kind of been our life. We don't know anything else. Like, so it'll be, well, we're going to feel like we have more time in the day. It's going to feel weird. Like, the day went up to 30 hours. So I'm really prepared for it. I'll be excited to just be a normal Joe.
Think she'll go back to coaching?
Maybe. She still does a little bit. Like, she did until the transplant. She coached my daughter's youth league. And I think once a coach, always a coach. And she and I will find ways to have meaningful interactions with the games that we love and the kids that we love.
Coach, I want you to talk about what it was like when you got the phone call from Nick Saban. And how did you even get Nick Saban's phone number, or how did he get yours?
He got mine, and he's Nick Saban. You know, he got everybody's phone number. In case you never know who you got to recruit. I'm sure he got it from ESPN. He's good friends with Gene Wojciechowski and all those crew and whatnot. And it was just really special for me, someone you idolize in the business, and to hear him say the things that he said, I really needed to hear at that moment, because you're having all the doubts and all the questions as to what's going on. And when he told me that it's really about loving your players, making sure that they get the best version of you at all times, and making sure that they're prepared for the world outside of football, and that you're making better people, better citizens, it made me feel good that that was our party line, and that's also his party line. And he's so different when he's personable than he is to, like, the media or other things. Just kind of hearing real him and getting the opportunity to just share that space with him for 10 minutes, which felt like a lifetime to me. And I apologized to him about 30 times. Like, Coach, you don't have time for this. Like, why are you doing this? You know, it says a lot about his character and who he is. And I'm not the only one that's received phone calls like that. I'm sure there are other people. He probably calls up everybody that's on every game day deal and gives them encouragement and words of hope, because that's the kind of great person he is. Because it's Nick Saban, that got publicized, but the email from Mark Richt emailed.
Yeah, I know Mark Richt.
He's my favorite coach. Well, Nick Saban's my favorite coach, but I love Coach Richt too. Tommy Tuberville was at Cincinnati when my wife was at Cincinnati, and he gave me complete run of their facilities. If I needed a place to rest, he said, you can come sleep in my office. You know, we'll get you food. We'll do whatever.
Wow.
And I think Coach Tuberville sometimes maybe got a bad rap in there because of how things went in Cincinnati, but to me, he's a remarkable human being and a good man, and it exemplifies what it means to be a great football coach. So people like that, and not those are the bigger names, but, you know, the Tom Allens that I use, the other coaches throughout the nation that have been so supportive, people stopping me at the convention and talking to me, and, you know, Coach James Franklin, people like that, just really awesome. And everybody's a football coach, right? And football coaches know football coaches. You know, there's a guy that you probably never heard of, Chad Brain, who used to be at East Stroudsburg, one of my best friends in the business, and his wife was going through a cancer battle about the time my wife started having problems, and has been a real inspiration to me and a good friend, and checks in on me almost daily. And you just, you know, there's just wonderful people out there.
Yes, sir.
In all levels of football, in all levels of sport, in all levels of community. And that's really amazing about our world. I have hope for a better future.
Yes, sir. I want to get your opinion on, we're going to take it back to football real quick. When the program got canceled, same thing in my book. And that actually made the national news as well. And, I remember seeing teammates doing, like, you know, local interviews and stuff. But then I saw it on an ESPN show. But then I really started to see it on social media. And they were killing us a little bit.
Yeah.
You know, I wanted to get your opinion when you saw that it went national.
Well, I knew it was going to. I mean, there's been such a production that had been made about it originally, and it kind of become a legacy thing that we were winless. I knew that when they decided to suspend it, that it was going to be a big deal in terms of media. So I was prepared for that. I wasn't quite prepared for some of the things that people said. I always questioned junior high kids, like, you know, the social media bullying, how you go through that. I wasn't quite prepared for some of the things that people said. But I think that's part of this job. You got to be ready for anything, and you got to be ready for people to just say whatever they feel is necessary. They got to get off their chest and attribute to you. And I know some of those things aren't sincere or real about me. I know some of it was just people being angry. You're a little shocked that people that once played for you or with you or you coached with or whatnot. And, some of the things they say, but it's within their right. They lost their favorite program. They lost their favorite team, and there's really no other finger to point but at me. So
yeah, I remember seeing Barstool Sports. They were the ones that really lit us up after the whole word got out.
Now that one bugged me a little bit, because I don't think the individual that wrote that had ever touched a football field, and I don't think that was fair. I don't think. You can say whatever you want to about me. I'm a grown man. I signed the contract to be the head football coach at Earlham College. I lost every single game as a head football coach at Earlham College. Whatever you feel needs to be said about my ability as a coach, my adequacy, my capability as a human being, that's fine. You have the right to do that. You do not have the right to attack our players. You do not have the right to pick on our student athletes. You do not have the right to pick on kids that were doing their very best for a game that they love, for a team that they love, for a school that they love. That's a shame, and that's sad that there are people that are that depraved. You can talk about the coaches, we wear that, but don't ever talk about kids. I don't talk about other people's kids, winning programs, losing programs in a negative, pejorative light. I don't think anyone in the media or sports world has the right to do the same.
Yes, sir.
Especially because you guys were all good guys and you're trying to do the right thing.
Yes, sir. But now we're going to transition back to Melissa. I'm glad to hear that the surgery went successful and that she's in recovering. You know, I really hope that you know, soon that she'll be able to finally come out the hospital in all good faith and everything going forward. Have you thought about the first thing you'll do as soon as she's released?
I'll be happy. I mean, if we had won a game, if we had won the national championship, if she got out of the hospital, the first thing I'm going to do is what she tells me to do. You know, my life's not different than anybody else. Like, you know, you go on ESPN and people are like, oh, that's pretty cool. I went home that night. She told me to take out the trash, do the dishes. I mean, it wasn't like anything special for her, you know. So life goes on and it continues. And I just wanted to continue with her. I wanted to continue with our family as one together.
Any plans for her coming back for a basketball game? You know, she came a few times last year.
Yes, she's a big fan of Coach Watson, and she wants to come back and see her and Coach Elston do their thing, and the kids, and that team's so supportive and wearing orange and doing things for Melissa all the time. So she loves the sport, and she's grateful that what she did here still exists.
You know, I remember the game last year where everybody wore orange, and then they honored her at halftime. That was pretty great.
Yeah.
I think it just goes back to shows that, you know, Earlham really, and not just Earlham, but everybody had the support of Melissa, and I don't think she truly knows how much she's affected positively a lot of people, in not only on this campus or in this area, but in the country.
Yeah, I mean, that's one of the reasons why I married her. She's a great woman.
Yes, sir. And we wish her a speedy recovery, and we wish her all the best. And Coach, I really appreciate you
got it, brother.
Coming on this show for me. Yes, sir. I thought,
appreciate you coming out here for me. It means a lot.
Yes, sir. And no matter what happened, I wouldn't regret. I wouldn't choose another school or redo that choice if I had the opportunity. I whether would I still like to play football? For sure. I've enjoyed my experience out here. You know, you were the one that put me on Radio Troy.
Hey man, yeah. Just anything I can do to help. You know,
yeah, a few more things we need to talk about outside of this podcast. Yep. But yes, Coach, I appreciate you coming on. Yes, you know, I think this story can really help people who watch it. You know, going through tough times. You know, to keep fighting, just the fight that your wife has shown. Sure. With the medical issues that she's gone through and. You know, getting enlightenment on the football story and how you were still able to be a head coach and still, you know, go through everything that you were going through with not just your wife, but also, you know, the kids, how they were able to handle it. And those are some very strong kids that you got. I'm fortunate to I've never had to go through a situation of stuff like that. I mean, I understand being afraid of my mom dying, being via war.
Yeah.
So I understand that aspect, but you have a very strong family, and again, not just me, but everybody, we wish your wife and your kids, you know, all the best. And we're praying for that day when Melissa steps out of the hospital and she doesn't have to go back.
Yeah, I'm praying for it, but I'm also apprehensive because I know as soon as she gets back, she's going to say a lot of things about the array of the house. Like,
I'm sure,
it's in disarray without her there, so she's gonna jump me pretty good.
You know, man. Sometimes you're like, do you even fully clean it? Because I've done situations where I've cleaned the house and it, you know, my mom be like, yeah, yeah.
Man, you see my office, man, you know, I be stuffing stuff under a rug. So.
Yeah, I'm with you on that one. But yes, Coach, appreciate you coming on. This has been Untold Sports Stories with Gerard O'Byrne. We will have more content up for you shortly. Appreciate you all tuning in. I wish you all a great night.